Hello?
Hello?
Yes?
Christian Prince?
Yes, you are live on air.
Okay, well, I'm live here too, and I just want to call you to tell you my experience and that I was Muslim.
Okay.
And I want everyone to know what I discovered to Islam. So first of all, I want to say that I converted to Islam. I come from a very, very broken family.
Okay.
I was a college student and I became homeless, right? It happened that in my university there was a big Muslim community. They talk nice to me, they sugarcoat things like usual. And I decided to convert because I said, okay, well, they're really nice. These are the only nice people that I have been around with. And I see that whatever they tell me, I was thinking it makes sense because they were saying, oh, we believe in Jesus Christ. And if we love Jesus, we respect Jesus, and Islam is a religion of peace, right? So I took Shahada. I want to admit publicly that I took it without me having zero understanding what is Islam. I just went outside and jumped and said, okay, I say the Shahada. Throughout time, I noticed that when I became Muslim, everyone was very nice to me. Everyone wanted me to pray for them. Everyone was trying to help me. Everyone, and from it was all sugars and rainbows until I started, praying at the mosque. People would come and fix my hair, hands during Salat, and say, "No, you're praying wrong," or what, or watching how every step I make, or the clothes I wear. And it was so uncomfortable at the beginning, right? Later on, I decided, well, one of my friends, she hosts me in her house, but and her mom is Islamic scholar. She's an Islamic scholar. And no scholar, sorry, it's more like Islamic school professor. So, and that she's from the Middle East, right? But I never, as I say, I never had any experience or contact with any Muslim people. So they taught me Islam, but the way that they taught me Islam was very, very aggressive. I didn't, I, you know, I'm from Latin America. I want to say I'm Latina. And in my culture, of course, it's very natural to shake hands, to greet by kiss. So they told me, they stopped me, it's like, no, that's wrong. And I felt really bad. I said, how is that wrong? But they were just pointing out things that I was doing wrong without telling me the reason. And I could feel bad because how can I? This is when I started to question things because I said, how can just a simple hand shake gesture will arouse any attraction between the opposite gender, right? Even for a job interview, no, you cannot. I ask. There's a lot of Muslim scholars who come to my university and do halakas and teach Islam. And I ask, okay, so how is it wrong to shake hands if you don't have a bad intention? And they told me an answer, like a solid answer. So from there on, things started.
What was the answer?
Oh, they said, oh, it's because we don't mix with the other gender. I said, but why? Is that because Allah knows best, and we know we're not supposed to be with them because we can, you don't know each other's heart, so it can arouse attraction. But if you think about it, how can just shaking hands arouse attraction to another person? Like, I'm just greeting the person, right? So from there on, I started like getting like a bad feeling, but I didn't listen to my gut, so I just went on. I just went on and tried to learn. I actually was really trying very hard to learn Islam, to pray, to memorize Quran, and to understand what Islam was because everyone around my environment was very religious, very, very religious. And I wanted to be that way, like, and for example, they would tell me you have to memorize Quran because when you die, they're gonna ask you who's your prophet, what you believe on, they're going to tell me to recite the Shahada, and they told me to that I have to memorize Quran. And then I started asking myself, well, how am I going to memorize something I can barely understand? But, you know, like, sometimes I would do something and question myself, but as I said, I didn't follow my gut this time until I actually started reading the Quran. And when I started reading the Quran, I got very, very shocked because I say, why, like, is this really true? So I went and I asked many sheikhs, many scholars about that. And they would say that, oh, you're not understanding Arabic, you need to understand the context. You need to learn Arabic because it's classic Fasih Arabic.
Mm-hmm.
But I want to ask you, Christian friend, something. How can people teach Islam or want to do do dawah on converts if they say that Arabic is a really high level language that no one can understand? How can they try to teach something that is high level to people that barely can speak Arabic? That's my question.
Well, you know what they say partly is true. Nobody can understand. The Quran is a very stupid book, you know. So if we give the Muslims a verse in the Quran and we ask them what this verse means, you will see they have 1,000 interpretation, if not 1,000,000. So how a language which is sent by Allah to guide us, they themselves cannot understand and they cannot have the same interpretation for, you know, what is the message there? So the Quran is a very stupid book made by a very stupid writer, and because of that, there's no, doesn't make sense. Actually, if I go to the comment, there's a Muslim, he posted in the comment, let me see if I can find it in the previous video. He said, how you say in the chapter of Mary, chapter 19, he said, how you say that the Quran is not connected, you know, doesn't make sense. The verse before and the verse after have nothing to do with it. So he mentioned that the verse of and the chapter of Mary as an example, all of it is about Mary. But is it true? If we go right now to the chapter of Mary, we will find that the part about Mary is just little. The most of the part have nothing to do with Mary. You know, here we go. This is about Mary. This is about Mary. This is about Mary. No, you know. And then what is this? This is about Mary. This is about Mary. This is about, no. And then here he speak a little bit about Mary, and then he jump. He starts speaking about things have nothing to do with Mary and have nothing to do with the teaching of Christ. You know, like who is the one is, you know, who is the one is talking here? So in the Quran, there is no connection between verses, and there is no connection between a verse and the one after it. You know, he talked about Mary. Okay, here we jump to Moses, and then we jump to Aaron. Why? Because Muhammad, he think that Aaron is the uncle of Isa. And who is Isa? We do not even know who is this name. So the Quran is a very stupid book, and this is why the Muslim, they try to fix the Quran. So when the Quran says he found the sun set in murky water, the Muslim, they have to add words to the verse in order to fix it. So they say it appeared to Alexander the Great that a sun set in, but Allah never said it appeared to him. He said he found it. So in order to fix stupidity, they have to fix the language, and they have to add words. So how the Quran is an amazing book, high level of language, when the Quran is given wrong meaning and wrong purpose of it. You know what I mean?
I understand. And this is my question, like, why they even try to do dawah? Like, if they know that there's something's wrong and they claim that the translation is inaccurate, how in the heck they try to still convert people into Islam? Like,
you see, it's like you're asking the Satan why he's trying to fool you. That doesn't make sense. So you should know that this is a satanic religion, and a person who follow it, he is possessed with the devil. So he has a duty, he's a, they're a prophet. They have videos about a guy, a Muslim guy, who made a Jew. I believe this is a fabricated story, but the sheikh is proud about it in YouTube. So he said, this is how we can, you know, this is the, look how smart our brother here. So there is, he said, there is a Jewish guy, he's a neighbor to a Muslim. The Muslim guy, he keeps saying to him, why you don't convert to Islam? Convert to Islam. Islam is better for you, you know, etc. So the Jewish guy, he said, you know what, I don't really mind converting to Islam, but I like to smoke and I like to drink. The Muslim guy said to him, who told you you cannot do smoke and drink? You can. The Jewish guy, he said, really? He said, yeah, just say Shahada. Say Shahada. The Jewish guy, he said Shahada, and he became a Muslim. Now, the Muslim, he grabbed a cigarette to smoke. The Muslim, he said to him, you cannot smoke. The guy, he said to him, but you told me I can. He said, yeah, I said that to you before you said Shahada. So they are saying that this guy, the Muslim guy, he tricked the Jewish guy to save him. He lied to him to save him. This is a good lie. Islam without lies dies. So they justify their lies by saying that we lie to save the people. We enslave you to save you, you know? So if we go actually here in the hadith, let me show you this in the hadith. If you ask a Muslim why you attack people and nations and enslave them and take them as sex slaves, why you do that? They say to you the answer in what the Prophet said.
Okay.
Read carefully. Abu Huraira reported that the prophets are saying, God charmed with people who will enter paradise in chains. They will enter heaven in chains. Why they will enter heaven and they have chains? Doesn't make sense. We have to search more. We go down a little bit. We find.
Okay.
Muhammad, he said to the Muslims, speaking to the Arab, you are the best of people ever raised up for the benefit of mankind. This is Quran chapter 3 verse 110. And then Muhammad explained that verse. You see, if you go on YouTube, all Muslims, they say this is, you see, the Quran says that the best of us is the one who is the best for mankind. This is what it says. But they will not say to you that this is about slaving and raping women of other nations. Read carefully. He said, the best of mankind of those who bring them with the chain around their necks till they embrace Islam. Thereby save them from eternal punishment and hellfire. So Muhammad, he told the Muslims that enslaving others is a duty of charity. Yeah, this is the, I'm showing the reference in front of you. You know, we don't say things without proof.
Oh my God.
Yeah. So
okay, this is just making it even worse.
Yeah. So those Muslims, because now you don't live in the land of Islam, they are not raping you and they are not taking you as a slave. But if you are, if Al-Qaeda controls, let's say you are a Mexican, I don't know where are you from, but let's say you are a Mexican and the Muslims took over Mexico and they will practice a true Islam and they invade your country, they can take you and rape you. And this is the Quran proving that all over. And enslaving you is part of the duty of the Muslim. It's an obligation, is not even a choice. As you see, Muhammad praising the Muslims and Allah praising the Muslims, saying you are the best of mankind. Why? Because you enslave others. Because by enslaving them, you force them to convert to Islam.
Oh,
and by the way, even those who convert to Islam, Muhammad, he refused to free them, most of them. As an example, Bilal, he was a slave of Muhammad. And Muhammad did not free him. Muhammad, he died and still Bilal is a slave.
Bilal was never free?
According to some Muslim, they claim that he was freed by Abu Bakr later. But the reference says that Bilal, he came to Abu Bakr and he says to him, if you bought me for the sake of Allah, will you free me for the sake of Allah? So obviously Bilal was begging, you know, for his freedom, and Muhammad never freed him.
Okay, so how can people believe that this cult then, if it's a duty for enslaving people, how can everyone of Muslims believe this is a cult from God? What? I'm sorry. But
well,
like,
this is what happened to you too. Don't be offended what I will say. You know, always I like to be honest. You were with them in the same jar. You are the same. How you believe in such a garbage, you know? Sorry to say that to you. So
you've been driven.
You see, actually your guilt is bigger than their guilt. Sorry to say so. Why? Because, okay, you were homeless, no problem. You were in need, no problem. and life was tough on you, I understand. But to convert to a religion, you do not know what it is, how that can happen.
Exactly. You know, I was desperate. I was like, basically, I really appreciate them. I don't have anything against them. They're really nice as people. But my concern is these things, like, just like something like this, like you mentioned, when I saw that Aisha got married with the prophet, and the prophet was really old, like he was 55 or 56, not sure how, and she was a little girl. If I'm not mistaken, there's even a hadith that says that she was still playing with her dolls.
Yes.
That's disturbing.
Yeah.
Really disturbing to think about that. And then my friends and other scholars, they excuse themselves saying, "Oh, but at that time, the girls are already mature. They're ready for marriage. Those are other times. Those are, she was already old. She was like, her body was developed because she's in the desert. It's really hot environment."
Uh-huh.
I mean, I'm sorry, but I don't know. Like, that's, in that point, I said, all right, there's something wrong. You know?
You see, first of all, the claim of she is in the desert. Well, now we have girls who live in the desert in Saudi Arabia, and they are 6 years old. They are the same as a girl who live in New York. They are still little girls. So this is a lie, and nothing changed. Actually, now, isn't it they say there's a global warming, which means now it's more hot? So girls, they have, like, are we talking about eggplant, and the eggplant will grow faster in a warm area? That is a stupid statement, you know? This is a human being. He have stages. He grow old by days, not by being exposed to the sunlight. We are not plants. So this is a false answer for a false cult to protect a predator, sexual predator for children. And until now, according to Islam, there's no age limit for how Muslim he can marry. Actually, you can watch my videos. It's on YouTube. Search for sex with infant. Debate with infant. The Muslims in their book, they says that it's forbidden for a Muslim to have intercourse with an infant. It's forbidden. However, he can, excuse my language, he can put his private part between her legs, but he don't enter. Infant.
What?
1 day old. Go watch the debate. Go watch it. You know, it's in YouTube. Just search for it. You know?
Of course.
And the Muslim, he was debating, and we are showing the reference in the screen, and we can show it right now. So this is an extreme, bad, ugly, disgusting cult. And the only way to defend this cult is to lie. And now they have articles saying that Aisha, she was 18. But all of us, we knew that Aisha, when Muhammad died, she was going through 18. She's not 18 yet. So Muhammad, he married Aisha after he died. So in order to avoid the problem, they start making false article about the age of Aisha. But Aisha herself, I mean, look at this. Is it Aisha saying I was 6 years old? You know, she is the wife. She is the one who was with the Muhammad. So she was 6 years old. She became a wife. According to Aisha, by the age of 9, he did intercourse. But between 6 and 9, he was molesting her. This is how bad this man is. He's a criminal.
I'm sorry, but like it's even more even disturbing about listening to this. I mean, but yeah, and I want to continue.
All
thank
right.
you so much for your reference, and thank you. No, like I want to say that yes, I was stupid, and I admitted of joining something without further research. But you know, when people is vulnerable, they believe on anything and everything, or they like any slight spark of hope, you know, they go for it.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And thank God, you know, I did well. Like I ended up finding a job after I graduated with my engineering degree.
Mm-hmm.
And everything went well, thank God. But in the process of me, like when I still had those questions, I met someone, and we decided to get married. He's Arab from the Middle East, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where we got married and everything, I was still a Muslim. And this time, I want to say I was still a Muslim. And, you know, he actually said, "Oh, my God, I love you. And, you know, it's better for me to marry you because I wanted to marry a girl to convert her to Islam. But it's even easier because you're already Muslim." So I guess he liked the idea of me being a convert to Islam, so he could teach me Islam. I don't know. But so we got married and everything, and you know, here I am. I'm still married to him. But I had an accident, and we had a very, very bad accident. And in that accident, he got really bad, and I also got really hurt. And I was I don't know what happened. So something changed my life inside of there, and I thought that I was really gonna die, and I really thought that it was the end for me. And all of a sudden, I say no, I turn myself. I don't know how, but I turn myself back to Jesus again, to Jesus Christ. And I say, please, I give my life to you. Like I really don't want to die, and I don't, and I hope that nothing happens to him, to my husband. And can you believe that after I pray that, like I got better, we got better, and he got out of he was in an intensive care, and he got out of intensive care. So I prayed to Jesus and I say, what is going on, you know? And he felt also he fell out of status in his visa because he's from obviously the Middle East. And the lawyer told me, I went and he told me he violated the conditions. He's most likely that he will get deported. And again, I turned myself to Jesus and I said, please, please don't take him away from me. I even though he's Muslim, but I put his life in your hands, and I put my life in your hands. But please make our situation better. From there on, I felt a very, very peace in my heart, in my head, because I want to tell you this. Even when I was Muslim, I'll pray 10,000 rak'ats. I'll pray at night. I'll go to the mosque, and I was still feeling disturbed in my soul. I was not feeling in peace. I wasn't feeling calm. I had there was something missing in my life. I had no peace whatsoever, Christian Prince. But after the accident happened, and after I prayed, believe me, that peace came back. And I want to tell you that my husband, by the grace of Jesus Christ, he has now a permanent resident card. In the interview, like he didn't know, like the interview went bad, but I stay up praying and reading the Bible before the interview. And the same day after even though the interview went like crap, but we got approved. And he told me, how did this even happen? How did this even happen? But I can tell you that me putting my life and my hands in Jesus Christ was the best thing that I could ever do. I was blind. I didn't have any peace. But after I started watching your videos, Apostate Prophet and David Woods, I start having a much clearer understanding of what I got myself into. And today I regret deeply of having putting myself in the situation. But I think that everything happens for a reason. And I want to say thank you because you're doing an amazing job and you're letting people to open their minds and their hearts and their brain. Right now, my duty, and well, I'm trying to do that. I'm trying to educate myself. I'm trying to learn more because I would love my husband to see one day the light of Jesus Christ. Because maybe that's too much for me to ask. But it's a hard task because
Why you don't ask your husband to call me or to speak to me right now?
I already told him he I have already talked to him, and I said, if you think because he tells me that you are a liar, that you're lying in the mouth of Islam, that you and at first I told him, okay, because he was saying, okay, David Woods and Apostle Prophet, they don't know Arabic. How can they be talking about this stuff? So I said, okay, well, the Arabic, right? But then when I told him about you, he said, no, he's lying. He's a liar, and he's an enemy of Islam. And I said, okay, if you believe that Islam has the absolute truth and it's the right religion, why you don't face them? Why you don't prove that Islam is the right religion? He said, he's not worth my time. So I was like, okay, so you're scared of him.
Okay,
like,
stop, please. Hold on. Hey guys, did you hear what she said? There's a guy in the chat, he is saying that Fifi, he got me busted, and he mentioned Imam Murrah, whatever. I say to all those Abdul, this lady who was an ex-Muslim, she just said to you something very important. As long as I did lie, call me and show me the lie, and then record it, and then spread it around and let people laugh. Why you don't face me with my lies? How come you are so good and show that be Muslims that I'm lying in a video you make debating yourself and you win? For sure you will. Muslims support you, whatever you say. So why they don't dare to call me and prove me that I am a liar? I'm here. I just said, who wanna call me? And this lady, she called me. I do not know her. Any Muslim can call me. So you have Muslim make tons of videos about me lying. Choose any of them and call me right now. And either we laugh at you and at them, or people will laugh at me. Like, we have this guy, his name is Arman Views. Arman, how are you, Arman? Call me right now and let us talk about Imam Murrah, and people will die laughing at you. Do you dare? You don't dare, you're a potato, son of Muta. Muta boy. So they are street boys, they don't dare to face. This is what we are saying. You see, look at the title. Why Muslims avoid debating Arab Christian? Because all what they say here will prove it to be false. Otherwise, trust me, they will be lined up to call me and to get me busted. But because they know that they are no match, they knew that they have nothing, they are bankrupt, they don't dare to call me. And in the same time, we have this guy who is saying, Fifi, why you don't ask Fifi to let me call him? I will call him right now. And he can choose any of the lies I say to talk about it, anyone. We can start from lie number one. So they are a bunch of kids, and you Muslims are desperate. And here we go. Number one lie, let me remind you. Your sister, she said that Aisha, she was a growing woman. She have her menstruation already. And we showed in the video and in the hadith that this is absolutely a lie. Because at the age of 14, still she don't have her period. So who is the one who lie? The sun set in murky water. Oh, it doesn't say that, CP. It appeared to Zulqarnain that it is sitting in murky water. And then this Abdul, this is why they are so angry from me. They said, this is the correct hadith, apostate prophet. Which one? Which one? This one, let me show it to you. Sorry, I will let you stay with me a little bit, you know? Okay. This is the correct hadith, okay? Okay, what is the correct hadith? What is the one, you know? This is the correct one. Okay, this is the one explain Islam for us. Yes, I agree with this hadith. This is absolutely the authentic. You go watch the video and die laughing. And what is the authentic hadith which those little girls, they agree with? They say that Allah Prophet said to Abu Dhar, do you know where the sun set? I replied, Allah and his apostle know best, for sure. They associate the name of their prophet and the knowledge of their God with the knowledge of Muhammad. They are mushrikeen, kuffar. He said, it goes and prostrate underneath Allah's throne. And Susu and Mimi and Fifi, they say, yes, this is correct. We agree with that. But this is what really, this alone is enough to prove Islam to be shish kebab. As long as they agree, all of them, about it, that this is authentic and this is true and this is the hadith which is telling the truth. You're a prophet, teach that the sun goes every day from the east to the west and sleep under, excuse my language, enter the butt of Allah.
Oh.
And then the sun will ask Allah for permission to go back. And then Allah, one day, will refuse, because this is the judgment day time, and he will say to the sun, go back where you came from. So who is the one who is lying? Abduz. Who is the one who is lying? Now you cannot say they don't agree. They said they agree with this hadith, and the video is there. They agree with it. They said, yes, this is the authentic hadith. Here the Prophet, peace be upon him, he responds to you. He respond to us? Absolutely.
So I was making the comparison of Muhammad, right? My understanding is that he's a caravan robber. He had multiple wives. He was asking for jizya. Mm-hmm. And these characteristics, if you think about it, oh, he killed people that went against him. Okay, if you think about it, these characteristics, I put Muhammad, and then I compare it to a cartel leader. That's what they do. They like
women. Yeah, exactly, exactly.
They go against whoever that kills them. And in Latin American countries, what they do is they ask for to business for tax protection money.
Right. This is
Islam. And if you don't give it to them, you kill them. So that's what a cartel leader does, right?
Actually, the mafia, the word mafia. The word mafia is coming from Islam. The word mafia, maybe you do not know. When the Muslims occupy part of Europe and they withdraw when they lost the war, then the criminals, they took over the business of the Muslims. So they come to the stores and they say, the same you used to pay to the Muslims, you have to pay us to protect you. The Muslims, they force you to pay, otherwise pay or die. So the mafia started with Islam. Even the word mafia is an Islamic. The word assassination is coming from Islam. This is coming from the word, from the person, his name is Hassan al-Hashash. He's a person who built a castle, and he gave drugs to the Muslims, and then he sent a letter to the princes or, you know, rich people saying, pay me or die. And if you don't pay him, he will send one of his edicted to assassinate the person because he refused to pay. This is exactly Islam today. Islam today, convert or you die. We will send you a person to stab you. Just yesterday, a Somalian person, he stabbed 4 Italian women and a child, he is 6 years old. Go search the news. So this is Islam. Islam is a religion of assassination. It is a cult. It is about sex. And if we ask Muslims and those who they are proud about their prophet, if we go in the Quran right now, we will find that Allah, he made a chapter or a verse in the Quran about the private part of Muhammad and how to make him happy. And this is only a privilege to the prophet. And what is the privilege saying? That Muhammad, he can sleep with all those women. In the top of that, any woman she can offer herself to the prophet to sleep with him. What does it have to do with God? A person already have tons of wives and he have tons of sex slaves. Why he need women to offer themselves? And those women, if we go and read the interpretation, it says that if a prophet, his eyes fall into a woman, and even if she is married, her husband must divorce her immediately. What kind of a prophet this prophet is, if his eyes fall into a woman? Like now you are married to this Muslim guy, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if Muhammad come to your house and he like you, your husband must divorce you so the prophet he can have you. And trust me, your husband don't say bad words, please. Your husband will do it happily. And tell your husband, what about you call this guy and ask him to challenge him, to show us what he just said about if Muhammad, he saw me, you have to divorce me so he can have me. Tell him, why you don't dare, just ask him, show us on the screen, don't debate the guy. Tell him, I challenge you to show me that the prophet, Islam teach that. And the prophet, he do that. Actually, he did that to his own son. He went to the son, that's his own son. He flirted with the wife, and all of this is in their books. Every single word we just said, it is in their books, and any Muslim can call me and prove me wrong. I will give you a few minutes to finish your story, friend, and
thank
we
you
continue.
So much. Okay. And I'm sorry, I didn't mean to curse. It's just I was very shocked to see. I mean, honestly, it's horrendous. Like, I have no even words to say it, but how can that even be called a religion? Like, how can they, I'm sorry, but if any Muslim is willing to give their wives to the husband just because he says so, please tell me where is the spirituality, the God part in there? that's not. Oh my God! I'm sorry, Christian Prince.
You know what? I will do something. I will send you a link in Arabic, and I want you to tell him. Can you read it for me?
Please send that to me, please.
Yeah, and tell him, are you proud about your prophet? And by the way, you do not need him to translate because you can use Google Translation. You know what I mean? You do not need him because if he tried to lie to you and says it doesn't say that, get him busted. Say, hey, listen, let us use Google Translation, and this is your official website. I can give it to you. Actually, let me give it to you from the official government website of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. So he will not say, oh, this is a website, anyone can make a website. This is government website. Let us go there. Here we go. This is the official government website of the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, and this is the link. I will give it to you in Skype.
Thank you.
Let me go to the chat. After you finish, you will see it in the chat there. Okay, here we go. And now I will say thank you for calling us. And I will be waiting for your husband. Tell him, be a man. And I advise you, my friend, this person, sooner or later, he will divorce you and he will find a new wife. Just wait. Time will come. This is because as long as he is a Muslim, this is what Muslims do. When the woman, she gets a little bit older, she gave him some kids, she got a little bit choppy, he go and find a brand new wife in the Middle East. As simple as that. I'm just sharing the truth. Even their prophet, he said, why you marry a previously married woman? Why you marry a woman, she is not a child? And I can show you the reference right now. Muhammad, he encouraged them to marry children who they are virgins, so they can be amused by them and they have fun. This is the reference in front of us. You see, this is the story. A man who married a woman previously married, or let us say she is not a virgin. So according to Muhammad, the correct thing to do is to go and find a little child. She is a baby, and to marry her and have sex with her. And here you see, actually, because if you say to you, oh, it doesn't say she is a little girl. It says that. It says the guy, he said, he answered the prophet, he says, the reason I did not marry a child, a young daughter, a young girl, because I want a woman to take care of my orphans. My brother, he died, and I needed a woman who should take care of them, not a girl like them. Oh. And let me give you the reference too for this one, so you can show it to your so-called husband. You know, by the way, I don't know, you said you are a Christian. A Christian cannot marry non-Christian.
I'm sorry, by the way, I want to say that I had no idea about that, because I was Catholic, my background is Catholic, but now I'm Christian, so I didn't even had
a I'm not asking you to divorce the guy. I'm saying, according to the Bible, a Christian woman, she cannot marry a non-Christian. However, you left the faith, and when you married him, you were not a Christian. So, you know, that can let it go. But this is, in Christianity, this is not married, because Muslims, they don't marry. Muslims, they have sex contract. It's called nikah. Nikah means the F word. So you sign a contract that he can F, excuse my language. He did not sign a contract he can marry. There is no marriage in Islam. This is why they are encouraged to start with two and a three and four. And actually, according to some, there is no limit. But if you could not do that, you go for one, which means Islam did not say you start having sex with one as a wife. Islam start with having sex with two and three and four, etc. And if you could not do all of those, then you go to the bankruptcy, which means you sleep with one only. That is not marriage. A person who believe that he can have many, many women, obviously he don't believe in marriage.
The more that you tell me about this, the more it's disturbing, it's sick, it gets.
Well, I'm here to share the truth with you. You know, I don't want to disturb your life as a person married to this person. Maybe he's a, maybe, you know, but you see what, from what you said to me, he sounds like he is not decent with you, because if he is saying Christian Prince is lying, tell him, can you show me the lie? I will call him, record him. He don't call me, record him. Huh? Record him. Say, hey, Christian Prince, you lie about this. You call me, you play his voice, we open it and we see who's lying.
Okay.
You know, and let us see who's lying. All right. Thank you for calling me. And
God
bless
you.
And we'll pray for you.
Before that, before you end the call, please keep doing what you're doing. You're awesome. And we need more people like you in this world.
Thank
you so much.
Thank you. Take care. God bless.
Have a wonderful day. Bye.
Bye-bye. All right. Anyone who speak against Islam, he is a liar. Zakir Naik saying the earth was not covered by water is not a liar.